Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio today is education and skills. As ever, I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers in order to try to get in as many members as possible. And at question number one, I call Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government when it last met with senior management of West College Scotland to discuss the colleges at Greenock campus.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, as the member knows, as he accompanied me, I visited West College Scotland on the 6th of July last year when I met the college principal, the chair and staff and discussed a number of issues, including the campus. I've since met college principals and chairs in a number of forums, including as recently as Tuesday of this week. This specific matter of the Greenock campus isn't one I can recall coming up in the intervening period, but of course such conversations would be for the college and the SFC to have.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Minister for that reply, and as he is very much aware that the Finnart Street campus in Greenock is past its sell-by date and needs to be replaced or have significant investment. My preference, understandably, is for a new building to replace it, but I do appreciate that budgets are tight, with the capital grant being cut from Westminster. But can the Minister outline the current Scottish Government position in relation to the future of the Finnart Street campus?
Minister.
President Officer, I'm obviously aware that there are these issues at Finnart Street. The Funding Council last engaged with the college regarding its estates plans, including managing RAC, on the 6th of March. SFC are currently developing a college infrastructure investment plan. As part of that work, SFC are asking each college to provide up-to-date baseline information on their estate in order to establish a robust understanding of the entirety of the college estate. Additionally, we are working on a revised asset disposal process so that colleges can sell unwanted land or buildings and retain a significant proportion of the value realised to invest locally. But in taking up this enhanced flexibility, colleges should be thinking creatively on how to maximise the value of their estates through innovative approaches, including exploration of collaboration and shared facilities.
Question number two, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to address any issues regarding the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming as set out in the recent Education, Children and Young People's Committee report on its inquiry into additional support for learning.
Cabinet Secretary Jennifer Ruth.
I welcome the Education, Children and Young People's Committee report on additional support for learning, and I'm grateful to everyone that contributed to the committee's inquiry and gave evidence to inform this important work. Education authorities have a key role in delivering the provision of additional support needs in Scotland, and it is therefore important that we engage fully with our key partners who work with us to deliver education in Scotland before responding. I made a commitment to the committee to pause our work on a progress report and updated ASL action plan whilst we consider the recommendations from the committee's inquiry, and I will provide a formal response to the committee by the 10th of July at their request, and I will then publish an updated action plan in the autumn of this year.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Now, I've been contacted by a number of constituents in recent weeks regarding placement requests considered then refused by the local authority. One of the frustrations of my constituents highlighted in the committee's report is the lack of information provided within refusal letters, as well as information for parents as to how their children's learning and support needs would be accommodated in mainstream education. The committee's report recommends that the Code of Practice and ASL Action Plan are updated to require local authorities to clearly set out to parents and carers the grounds for refusal, and crucially, what support is going to be made available to their child. Will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that she'll work with COSLA and indeed other agency to swiftly ensure that these updates are made?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her interest in this matter, and obviously those frustrations were evidenced by the inquiry's evidence sessions, of which I took cognizance of, and have been very keen that we in government listen to the committee's findings and therefore reflect that in our updated ASL action plan. To that end, I was very clear in my own evidence to the committee that there is a need to provide more clarity for parents and carers, particularly in relation to those placing requests that the member alludes to. The action plan has a very strong focus on improving the consistency and the visibility of our communications on ASL policy, and the legislative position which will address the points made by the member. We're also committed to refreshing the ASL code of practice, and work is ongoing in this area too.
And supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This morning I visited Call Scotland at Edinburgh University and had the opportunity to see the fantastic work they do. A particular concern they shared is the fact that of the 76 actions in the ASL action plan, none of them are on inclusive digital learning, and it only mentions assistive technology once. The Doran Review made recommendations on this 12 years ago, and I understand the government is focused on the Morgan Review, but it would be a lost opportunity if the Doran Review was shelved. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what is she doing to ensure inclusive digital learning can happen in every school where it's needed, and what reassurance can she give to Call Scotland that inclusive digital learning will remain a key part of her response to the intolerable circumstances that pupils with ASN face?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a really important matter, and in relation to the role that digital technology can play, particularly in supporting those with additional support needs in our schools. I'm more than happy to write to the member in relation to the specific point she makes. I think it's important that government listens, though, to the committee's inquiry's findings. We had hoped to publish the ASL action plan in advance of the committee's report. I paused that so that I could listen to the committee's challenge on this, and I think it's important we do so. And on digital learning, I will write to the member in more detail. She is correct to say that the ASL action plan is predicated on the Morgan Review, which published more recently in 2020. But it's important we don't lose the learning from the Doran report too.
Question number three, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has reconsidered collating information on the number of children who are missing from education in light of its reported failure to do so to date.
Cabinet Secretary.
Children missing from education is different from persistent absence, and this measure relates to children of compulsory school age who are not on a school roll and not being educated otherwise. The current approach in Scotland is that someone deemed to be missing from education would be a welfare concern, and that should be followed up by local authorities in line with their statutory requirements for the delivery of education locally. However, I continue to consider further the need for national level data on this matter, and to that end, I have requested further detailed advice from my officials on the legalities of gathering further data of this nature, and I will update the member in writing on this point in due course.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful and I look forward to receiving that update, but I am disappointed that this hasn't moved on since I first raised it before Christmas. Does the Cabinet Secretary, though, agree that one of the key ways to tackle child poverty is through education? And if so, shouldn't this government be moving heaven and earth to collate this information and remove any of the barriers that she's just talked about to its collation so that solutions to help children missing from education can be found?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree absolutely with the sentiment behind the member's question. Of course, the law in Scotland is slightly different to other parts in the UK, which is one of the reasons why this data measure is not captured in the same way in Scotland at the current time as it is in other parts of the UK. But there is an urgency here. One of the things I undertook last year was a greater collection in relation to persistent absence. We now have that new measure. That data set was introduced in our data for the first time this year, and I think it's important the member recognises that, because we have seen an uptick in relation to persistent absence, particularly post-pandemic, with young people not engaging with the formal education system. But look, I think the member raises a hugely important point. I have more detailed data on this in relation to the legalities involved that I'm going to write to him about later today. And I'm also hopeful that I can put that on the record, Presiding Officer, in relation to updating the rest of Parliament.
And supplementary, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the confirmation of the welfare issue that arises from this lack of data. So can she tell the Chamber how she intends to comply with Article 27 of the UNCRC next month when the bill becomes active law in this country?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. In relation to the specifics of his points on the UNCRC, I'm more than happy to write to him specifically. I think it is important, though, that our actions in government marry up, of course, to the requirements of that legislation. And I will take official advice on that matter, but I would imagine that our approach here would need to be in line with the UNCRC's requirements.
Question number four, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any discussions that it has had with universities across Scotland about how public money is used, including in relation to any activities that may impact the ongoing conflict in Palestine.
Minister Graeme Dey.
Presiding Officer, the requirements that institutions are expected to comply with in return for public funding are set out in the SFC's financial memoranda for colleges and universities. The Scottish Government meets regularly with SFC and University of Scotland to discuss any issues of importance, including how we can work together to manage public spending to ensure public money is fully focused on delivering a well-being economy. The Scottish Government's position on the conflict in Palestine is clear. We call for an immediate, permanent ceasefire by all sides. As autonomous bodies, we expect universities to have in place measures to safeguard students and staff and continue to build interfaith relations on the campus.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for his response. He'll be aware of several Palestine solidarity camps on campuses across Scotland. Supported by the Students Association and Folk Across Aberdeen, the encampment at the University of Aberdeen is calling for the university to divest from all investments relating to the arms industry. No money intended for education should be used to fund war, directly or indirectly. And until it fell at dissolution, the university was using the Economic Activity of Public Bodies Overseas Matters Bill and TBDS legislation as an excuse for not divesting. Can the Minister confirm whether the Scottish Government stands by its policy note from 2014 that states, and I quote, "The exploitation of illegal settlements is likely to be regarded as constituting grave professional misconduct," and does he therefore believe that no institution in receipt of public money should be financially engaged in Israel?
Minister. I am aware, of course, of the campus encampments and fully support the right to freedom of expression. Regarding the procurement policy note that Ms Chapman raises, and I hope she'll realise that procurement is not my area of expertise, but the substance of that note remains unchanged. Ms Chapman is correct to say that this means the exploitation of assets in illegally occupied territories may constitute grave professional misconduct for the purposes of procurement legislation. Equally, it is true that any decision to exclude a bidder from a procurement process must be taken on a case-by-case basis, be proportionate and be compliant with our international obligations in relation to procurement and trade.
Question number five, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it will increase the take-up of modern foreign languages in schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to language learning in our schools, which is why since 2013 we've provided local authorities and third sector partners with funding of more than £50 million to support the implementation of the 1+2 languages approach. A 2021 survey of local authorities confirmed that pupils across Scotland are now learning languages from primary one. This is an important change since the policy was introduced 10 years ago. We continue to promote the uptake of modern languages through the support that is provided to schools by Education Scotland and through the funding of the University of Strathclyde, which hosts Scotland's National Centre for Languages.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that? You know, in the long and distant past, when I was at secondary school, over 12,000 of my fellow Scots studied a higher modern language. By 2003, that number had dropped to 8,000 pupils. 10 years later, it was 7,000. And last year, just 5,500 students did a modern language at a higher level. And that's no coincidence, Cabinet Secretary, because we've lost over 500 language teachers over the last decade. I also studied two languages at a higher level, something which is a bit of a luxury these days. I have to say, for a government which proclaims to be so international and outward-looking, how do we let things get so bad in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his interest in this. And of course, when the member and I were at school in the dim and distant past, the curriculum required us to study a language up until the end of S4. It was mandated. So the challenge the member puts to me today really is about the level of mandating the government has in the curriculum. And this was something I discussed with the Education Committee earlier this year. And of course, I will come to the Chamber very shortly to update the member and update parties, I should say, on the whole of Parliament in relation to the government's response on the Hayward Review. But let's look at some of the more recent statistics in relation to languages uptake. We have seen entries in the senior phase in National 4 and National 5 increasing between 2022 and 2023, and entries at higher level have remained relatively stable. Entries for Modern Languages for Life and Work Award SEQF Level 3 and 4 have quadrupled since 2013, and across SEQF Levels 3 to 7 entries to all languages qualifications have increased by 3.4% between 22 and 23. So there are signs of progress. I accept the challenge from the member, and I hope he also accepts the wider challenge around Scotland's curriculum at the current time, which is whether or not we need to go back to a system which mandates languages learning to a certain level.
And supplementary, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The opportunity to study and to have exchange abroad is an immense benefit to learning a foreign language, no matter when you are studying that language, whether that's at school, in the past, or now, or in the future. But Brexit has robbed that opportunity for many young people, and we have the axing of the Erasmus Plus programme. Meanwhile, Labour and the Conservatives have rejected the EU Commission proposals that would have made it easier for young people to study in the EU up to the age of 30. So can I ask the Government what steps the Government is taking to support students who wish to undertake study and exchange abroad?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, exposure to native voices and the opportunity to enjoy the culture of different countries is hugely beneficial for language learners. That's why the UK's decision to withdraw from the popular and successful Erasmus Plus programme was so self-defeating. And the replacement, the tutoring scheme, is much less effective. It helps fewer students and it does not help staff at all. It does not enable overseas students to come to Scotland additionally. In 23-24, the government has piloted a re-established scheme in relation to looking at the opportunities that Erasmus Plus has provided us with. And whilst that project won't be able to deliver the full benefits of the Erasmus Plus programme, it will support student and staff exchanges and help to develop stronger partnerships between educational institutions.
I call question number 6, Ros McCall.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the National Plan for Action announced in November 2023 to tackle violence in schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
As Ms McCall will be aware, since my appointment announcement in November, I have been working with members of the Scottish Advisory Group on Relationships and Behaviours in Schools to develop that National Action Plan. This means it has been informed rather by representatives of COSLA, ADES, Education Scotland, the main teaching unions, educational psychologists and parents and carers organisations. And as I confirmed when I met with opposition spokespeople in April, my intention was that the plan be published in late May or early June. However, as the member is aware, we are currently in a pre-election period, as a result of which I am currently considering advice from officials regarding publication timescales.
Ros McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and as she's alluded, we are 6 months on, and we are no further forward, and I accept there is a general election going on, but I am still receiving emails highlighting instances of raising violence in classrooms across Fife. A constituent who is also a secondary school teacher got in touch with me recently and said this: two of my colleagues have been verbally and physically assaulted in the last couple of days. It's clear that there is a significant problem within all Fife schools at the moment. Pupil indiscipline and the abuse faced by staff is the worst I have ever experienced. So given the First Minister's statement earlier on that we need to focus on what we can do rather than what we can write down, is there any action that the Scottish Government will take to address this now? And will the Cabinet Secretary agree to look with me at this particular case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Ros McCall has taken a keen interest in relation to these issues over a number of months, and I commend her for that. In relation to the specific challenge in Fife, of course, I think there's been a new Director of Education appointed in Fife very recently. I know that as a constituency MSP in Fife, I'm more than happy to work with the member on this. I should say to the member, too, that the Behaviour Action Plan is part of the solution here, but we are talking fundamentally about cultural change in our schools. And action plans in themselves do not drive the change we need to see. So whilst that will help, I think, to give impetus at national level, we need to see cultural change in our schools in relation to changed behaviour and relationships post-pandemic. And I commit to working with the member and to meeting with her on that.
Supplementary, Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Prevention of violence is always preferable to mopping up the consequences of it. Can I ask it what work the Scottish Government is funding to support schools in that prevention agenda?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member is right to highlight the role of prevention. That's why, of course, we are investing over £2 million this year alone to implement the violence prevention framework to help divert people away from violence. That framework is supporting Medics Against Violence in their school education programme to deliver strong anti-violence messages to pupils. It's also supporting Mentors in Violence Prevention programme to train 1,000 young mentors to provide gender-based violence sessions within schools across Scotland. And we will, of course, report on the implementation of the framework later this year.
I call question number 7, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, as part of its cross-government support for learning disabilities, autism and neurodiversity, what discussions the Education Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding how the proposed Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill will help people into work?
Minister Natalie Dunn.
The Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill aims to ensure that the rights of neurodivergent people, including autistic people and people with learning disabilities, are respected, protected and championed. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills is supportive of the bill and the ongoing work of the Scottish Government in this area. Officials will continue to explore wider education and employability policy and practice to further support people with learning disabilities and neurodivergent people to access fair and sustainable employment.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for the answer. I want to know how the government will ensure that there is a holistic approach across government, education, health, social care and skills to create opportunities to allow LDAN people to work. And how do we garner the voices of lived experience to get all of this right for people?
Cabinet Secretary. Oh, sorry, Minister.
I think Mr Stewart raises some really important points there, and I would highlight there are a range of policies across government which holistically support neurodivergent people and people with learning disabilities. These include employability actions under our No One Left Behind delivery plan, Skills Development Scotland's work with schools to support young people with additional support needs, and our Fair Work Action Plan. Scottish ministers have also committed to introducing Scotland's first national transitions to adulthood strategy to ensure there's a joined up approach so that all young disabled people can experience a supported and positive transition to adult life. And going forward, it is an absolute priority to continue to embed the voices of lived experience in our work through public engagement and consultation.
And I note we have a wee bit of time, so I'll call Pam Duncan-Glancy for a supplementary.
Thank you for your indulgence, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister is right to point out the importance of transitions for this group of people, and I wonder whether the Minister could say on the record just now whether whether the Government is considering elements of the Transitions to Adulthood Bill that could be now part of the LDAN Bill that the Government will bring forward.
Cabinet Secretary, Minister.
I thank the member for that question, and the member is aware of the most recent update that I've provided in relation to the transition strategy. In terms of those exact points in relation to the LDAN bill, I'd be happy to update the member on that in writing.
And question number 8, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of how it is working to ensure free music tuition to pupils in school across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
This Government has transformed instrumental music tuition in Scotland's schools by funding councils to eradicate unfair music tuition charges. And this year alone, we are providing £12 million to local authorities to support the continued delivery of free instrumental music tuition as part of record funding of over £14 billion provided to local authorities in the budget. The most recent instrumental music survey, published in December of 2023, shows the number of pupils participating in instrumental music tuition at a record high since the survey began.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. Several councils, led by different parties, have cut funding to music lessons, so the Scottish Government's funds cover the whole cost of lessons rather than just the removal of fees. Councils have control of their own affairs and deal with tight budget. But can the Cabinet Secretary outline how a new Scottish Education Agency will ensure there is equal access to music tuition across all of Scotland so the postcode lottery of music provision does not return?
Cabinet Secretary.
For his question, and I did allude in my original answer to the record levels of funding that Scottish Government is providing local authorities with at the current time. And of course, part of that funding is that additionality we are providing to help provide free music tuition across the country. I think the member's broader point about the new education agency is an interesting one. And of course, I will be coming to the Parliament to bring forward that legislation, which lodged yesterday in due course. And I think it's a matter, of course, across the chamber about some of the differences in relation to educational delivery across the country. That's because our local authorities are entrusted at local level to make the right decisions for the children and young people in their care. However, I think there is an opportunity to look at greater parity of esteem across the board, irrespective of subject choice, and I think music is one of those issues that we will need to look at in further detail through education reform.
And supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I know from personal experience, music education is a wonderful way for children to explore creativity, and it can open up avenues into careers in the music sector. However, thanks to Brexit, we have witnessed the music sector be torn apart due to lack of funding, opportunities and freedom of movement. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how Brexit's impact on the music sector has impacted students' likelihood to pursue music education, and what more we can do to support them?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's a number of things that we can do to support them, and one of the underpinning aims of the culture strategy is to ensure that those who are motivated to realise their aspirations to have a career in the creative sector are equipped with the skills for success. That includes the promotion of creative subjects at all stages of education and learning, and demonstrating really clear pathways that enable people to succeed. Brexit, of course, has put in place significant new barriers which have had a negative impact on the opportunities for creative practitioners, in particular in relation to their work internationally. That's why, of course, we are calling on the UK Government to rejoin Creative Europe and are urging them to engage positively with the EU Commission proposal to open negotiations on youth mobility.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on education and skills, and there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.